Dear students, here is a follow-up video lecture on loss functions and regularization in multi-class classification. In the last video lectures, I have introduced multi-class SVM loss function based on the classification scores, and I have also introduced softmax loss function using these scores for multi-class classification, respectively in the previous two video lectures. In this video lecture, let us understand the properties of softmax loss function or cross entropy loss and also understand how to enforce regularization or what is the need of regularization in multi-class classification. Let us resume back to the discussion we had. Here we were discussing about the loss function, cross entropy loss function, which is obtained after softmax layer. So use of softmax layer in a neural network makes these scores to be converted to probabilities, and these probabilities in turn can be used for constructing the loss function by comparing the probability density that we had. So just to give a review, so we have the true probability as PT, which is one for only the for the label which is correct label for that sample yi, and zero for all j, which is not equal to the output neuron having the correct classification label. And this is the true probability density function. Using this course, we have converted the two probabilities through softmax layer, and this is the this is what is the probability at the softmax layer. And using these two probabilities, we have applied KL divergence on these two probabilities to compare the PDFs, which in turn boils down to cross entropy loss and is given by this, okay, which is PT is non-zero only for this term, remaining all terms get multiplied with zero and hence doesn't occur in the final loss, cross entropy loss. So please note that in the cross entropy loss, we have the term corresponding to e power s yi and normalized with all other scores through ln, and hence this is the cross entropy loss for given sample xi. Based on its score s yi for the corresponding for the neuron having the correct label, supposed to have the correct label or highest probability. And now we are understanding the properties of this softmax loss or cross entropy loss, and specifically we are trying to understand the limits of it. Please note that in the previous discussion, at the end of previous video lecture, there was a small mistake. It's corrected here. So ln was not there in the previous discussion, and which leads to some confusion and difficulty in arriving at the limits. Now let us consider the correct function and see what are the limits for this. So now assume that the score is very high. In such case, we have all other scores are close to zero, assume that, and in such case we have minus ln of infinity, so which is minus ln of e power plus infinity, which is minus infinity, plus, so let us break this loss function li into two terms here as as indicated here. So minus ln of e, this is the first term corresponding to the score of the output neuron that's supposed to have the correct label, or the highest probability, and these other scores along with this sum of exponential of each of the scores of all neurons. So please note that if SYI is infinity, the first term is minus infinity, second term is plus infinity, so Li is zero. So the loss, the minimum possible loss for the maximum possible score is zero. And in case 2, let us assume that SYA is minus infinity. In such case, if we just substitute minus infinity here, and the first term becomes infinity, and second term, assume that e power minus, say, in the second term, if we just make sure, if we substitute SYA equal to infinity in the second term, e power minus infinity comes, which is close to 0, and remaining terms will not be 0 in summation e power sk. Okay, so to all together this becomes C. Okay, so and this is what is Li. Now Li is plus infinity. So the this is for the minimum possible score for the neuron having the correct label, or neuron corresponding to the correct label, output neuron corresponding to the correct label. Okay, so the loss functions of cross entropy loss varies between 0 to infinity. 0 for the correct classification, minimum error, minimum possible error, and infinite for very erroneous case. So now let us examine the third question that we had, almost similar to the discussion we had for the multi-class SVM cost function. So assume that now initially the network is initialized with assume that the network is initialized. This is random weights. Okay, and here is anyway x input, and let this be output, and here are scores for us. Okay, so and since this is random uniformly initialized, say between minus epsilon to plus epsilon, then it's likely that each of the values of s1, s2 are roughly same. So this is s1 is approximately equal to s2. There is no choice, no preference that one s1 may be greater than the other, or and vice versa. So as given this condition, so what can we write about SYI? This is e power SYI. E power SYI by summation over e power s k. This becomes, so each are equally likely in some sense. So then equal in some sense. So it is 1 by c. So minus ln of 1 by c, which is ln of c. So where c is the number of classes. So if we have actually 10 class problem, 10 class classification problem, if we have, then initial loss with random weight weights is what? Ln of n of, yes, so this is ln. Okay, this is roughly ln of 10 is roughly 2.8. So this serves as an initial check, or a very good check, to see whether the network that we have that we formulated is correct or not. Okay, fine. So usually this is the first step people check when they formulate or construct the networks, to verify the subsequent convergence for the loss and training. So examine the next question that we had. So if there is a small change in any of these scores, how does it affect the loss function? So assume that we had some sets of scores here and another sets of scores here for some sample which is belonging to top class. Assume that now 4 is changed now to 4.9. Okay, so in such case what will happen? Sorry, 4.9 is changed to 4.5. In such case what may happen? Initially if the scores are 4.9 for dark class, then it is the correct sample is belonging to dark class. So e power 4.9 by the rest of the exponentials. So you get roughly, assume that you get roughly 0.7. Now let us assume that there is small change in scores, and then because of the exponential things, the variation here will be very small. So the loss will be almost close to the previous loss. So small scores in small changes in scores doesn't affect much. That's why the name softmax also comes to this. And finally, once we want to find the total loss using all samples, loss of each sample, then it is summation over all samples or average over all samples, loss of all samples. Okay, so let us move on to the next discussion on regularization. So far what we have discussed is how to construct few of the well-known loss functions like cross entropy loss or multi-class SVM loss. In spite of having very good loss function, the network all the time may not generalize well the classification. That means, say for example, if we have a assume that this is the loss curve. So this is L for some network, and this is over iterations or epochs. So one pass through whole data set is called one epoch. So let that be actually 10 epochs, 20 epochs, and so on, and then 40 epochs. Okay, assume that usually what should happen is the training loss will decrease. So this is how the training loss, assume that this training loss. Okay, so that means L, whatever I am considering. Okay, and then after some time it may saturate. And test loss, for example, so if I usually, as we discussed before, the data set is split into train, test. Train, let it be say 60%, test data is 20%, and validate data 20%. Okay, assume that we have split the data set into this data, okay, whole data. For training the neural network. So now what training loss is decreasing and then it converged also after a while, assume that. But now if we validate on a data set which is not seen in training or not included in training, then there is no guarantee that it also has the same drop in the loss function. So it may be something like this. Okay, so it means that it is not dropping as there is a gap between them. Okay, there is a gap between them. This gap usually is more and more if the data set is trained with heavily with the small data, or even if it is trained with a data which doesn't span the generalized well to the validation set. So this is known as overfitting. This can be attributed to, this can be minimized by overfitting of data. Okay, so this can be minimized if we avoid overfitting of data. Let us, if we test with, for example, some test data set, so it may even be like this. This is the loss curve on the test data set. That means as the iterations or the epochs increases, the loss drops, but it doesn't drop as good. There is a drop in the training data. So this gap is also can be usually attributed to overfitting. Okay. So to reduce overfitting, what people do is they will not completely get carried away by the training loss. are the loss which is given by the data set or the training data set. But people also introduce some measure on the weight vectors or the parameters to be found or trained. Say, let us consider a small example to understand the importance of regularization. This is known as regularization. To understand the regularization, let us consider a small example. Let there is a loss, a simple loss function like this, where x, there is a sample xi given to a network, and yi be its label, and w are the set of parameters which will map input sample xi to label yi. Let all these be let yi be scalar now, and let yi be equal to, say, yi or y is equal to 1 for this instance, and then x be a sample, so, and which is 1 1 1 1, like 4 cross 1 sample with all 1s. Now if we have a simple cross function like this, so what we are trying to do is we are trying to estimate the output at some output neuron. Given x are the features or inputs for the input layer, and w are the weights connecting the output neuron to the inputs. So in this case, what is the relation between y and w and x? So y can be related to w transpose x, and assume that there is no activation function here, so it is linear activation function, so y equal to w transpose x. So, and then the error in this case is L in this case is y minus w transpose x. Okay, so this is the error in this case, error function. Okay, so given this scenario, now what we wish to do is, how does the what is the need of regularization in this scenario? Will there be any additional benefit that we get from regularization? See, here this is the loss function, and this is the loss function if we consider many samples. So now let us get into the example to understand it better. So x is all 1s, 4 cross 1 vector, and y is equal to 1. So in such case, what, say, assume that there are 4 possibilities for w. So one possibility is this 1 0 0 0, another possibility is 1 by 4 1 by 4 1 by 4 1 by 4, and third possibility is this, and fourth possibility is this. See, now in all these 4 cases, now if we calculate the loss, what is the loss in each of these 4 cases? Please substitute here, and you can see that w transpose x is equal to 1 in each of these 4 cases. So w transpose x minus y is equal to 0 in each of these 4 cases, and the loss is 0 in 4 cases. So now the question is, if there are several possibilities for the loss function, several possibilities for w which will minimize the loss function, which of them should be considered as the correct possibility or a better possibility for w? Are the weight vectors or the parameters? So usually what people do is, people prefer to have the simpler solutions in such cases. If there are several possibilities, the solution that people usually consider is good, is the simplest possibility. So please note that, assume that there are some samples like this. Okay, so now the question is, given these samples, what we wish to do is, we would like to fit some polynomial or polynomial to the samples, okay, or any linear function to the samples. Yes, we wish to fit some function to these samples. Okay, assume that the samples are like this. So now the question is, here I have depicted two functions. One is a very quite non-linear function, which is fitting all the samples almost more accurately, and other is somewhat linear function. So given the choice, for example, if so which one we would like to take is the question. See, if we consider the green line, which is a multi degree polynomial or high degree polynomial, then typically the y and x, for example, if x is the variable here, if x is a variable, okay, and then this is the y, Okay, so x and y can be related through a function like this. So w naught x plus w1 x1 square plus w2 x3 square plus and w4 x4 x s power 4 sorry w naught x plus w1 x square plus w3 x cube plus w4 x power 4. Given this is one possibility, that is this green line. And the simplest possibility here in this case is w naught into x. So given these two choices, which is more preferred is a question now. So but see, for these training samples, whichever data samples I have given, the first option looks, that is green line, looks to be quite a perfect fit. But these samples are random. So when I have a testing samples somewhat looking different from these samples, assume that they are random. So there may be like this. They may, because these are test samples, these can be some random samples. Okay, so these are test samples. So you can notice now the training curve, if we fit with the green polynomial, will not fit to this test samples. So the better curve that fits to the samples probably is a straight line. So the generalization capability is much better if we fit the function with a smallest possible degree polynomial, or smallest number of parameter, or with among the different possibilities that we have, whichever is the simplest option in some sense, that is more welcome in many of the applications than having a complex solution. So simple solution, to assess the simplicity of the solution, we have several different ways of doing, and which are quite commonly used ways are to use a L2 loss function or an L1 loss function to see which is like simplest solution among these W1 to W4. So L2 loss function is finding second norm of W for each of these possible weight vectors or possible parameter vectors, and the one which is having the simplest or minimum L2 norm is considered as the simplest solution. This in some sense says that, say if there are several possibilities, the one which is having the minimum energy among these possible parameters, or the minimum square sum, is the one which is considered better. So these are the definitions for L1 and L2 norms. Please note, I hope you are well aware of these definitions. Now let us examine with L2 norm or L1 norm, how does the solutions change. So now consider that this was the cost function we discussed before, or data loss is also called, and this is regularization term incorporated to avoid overfitting. So assume that the L2 norm of each of these, if we calculate, we can see that the L2 norm for the W2 is minimum, and hence that becomes the best solution among these four possibilities. Because please note that the cost or data loss is zero for each of these. So if I modify my cost function, so this is this you can consider it as cost function with L2 norm or modified cost function. So now, this is the among these four possibilities, 1/4, 1/4, 1/4, 1/4 is being suggested by L2 regularization. Please also note that usually L2 norm suggests a solution which is more spread across the parameters space. See here, it's equally distributed among all possible all elements of W. And whereas L1 norm, for example, so if we consider enforcing L1 norm, minimum L1 norm in the cost function, then the cost function will get modified as, so now L is equal to, with L1 norm is Y minus W transpose X, let lambda be 1. Okay, so in that case what may happen, please note that here we have slightly modified the example, and X is now 1100 and Y is 1. In these are the possible solutions. Among these possible solutions, if we calculate the L1 norm, then you can see that the L1 norm is minimum for this solution. Okay, while the others also satisfy W transpose X minus Y equal to 0, they doesn't have the minimum L1 norm. And hence, this is being picked by L1 regularization. So please note that the solution given, usually proposed by L1 norm, is most of the time sparse, and it has good ability to pick the solution which takes only few elements of W in the final as the best solution. So among all possible values of possibilities for W, it picks the solution which will have the minimum number of non-zero elements in the solution. So this is also widely used for getting away with the regularization. In this case, it appears that it is knocking off the connections with other neurons and only enforcing the connection where there is a importance to decide the output correctly. Okay, this is the modified cost function with lambda equal to 1, as we discussed. And usually, thus, the total loss here is sum of cross entropy loss plus regularization loss. And there are several other ways of enforcing regularization, and the loss functions also can be changed from application to application. Usually, employed loss functions are cross entropy for classification, and for regression, people use mean square error loss function. Regularizations, people use both L2 and L1 regularization often. So once we train with several samples, usually these regularizations are enforced on with each of the mini batch samples of with each of the mini batch. People train while considering the mini batch as the input, and enforce calculate the loss function and enforce the backpropagation, apply the backpropagation on the mini batch. So people also use to avoid regularization, to avoid overfitting, further other steps to other important methods to avoid overfitting are batch normalization, batch normalization is also widely used. As I discussed, when they have a small batch, mini, which is known as mini batch, say 100 samples out of large number of samples, so they enforce normalization of each of the feature using its mean and variances often, and then that is referred to as batch normalization, and feed into the next layer. So usually they enforce batch normalization as a layer. Between people also apply first decorrelate the data and give input to the network, and dropouts is also one of the way. Training the network. Okay, this has several ways, say drop or drop neuron, drop connect. So connections also they drop, sometimes even layers they drop. So other is provide data, which is in more data normalization, provide data. And augmentation. So train with augmented data. Thank you.